AMD just announced new Ryzen 6000 CPUs and Radeon graphics for laptops. Here's everything you need to know about what's coming this year. AMD's new Ryzen 6000 series of mobile processors use their new 6nm Zen 3 Plus with RDNA 2 for integrated graphics. This year, AMD have been able to get clock speeds up to 5 GHz for the first time. Just for quick context, best case, last year's Ryzen 9 5980HX, their top-end laptop processor, had a max boost clock of 4.8 GHz. We're also looking at 2x gains to iGPU performance, which is quite large. More on that soon. Zen 3 Plus laptops are still up to 8 cores and 16 threads like last year, so lower core and thread counts compared to what we're expecting to see from Intel 12th gen this year. And based on that alone, I'm expecting Intel to have the lead in multi-threaded workloads. But for single-threaded tasks and gaming, well, it may be a closer battle. I'll be comparing them myself soon. Here's a list of the new features coming to Ryzen 6000 laptops this year. We're looking at DDR5 4800 memory, USB 4, and PCIe Gen 4 with 8 lanes for the discrete graphics, same as Intel this year. This means Ryzen finally gets access to faster Gen 4 SSDs. Here are the actual specs for all of the Ryzen 6000 laptop processors coming in February this year. All of the new H-series chips are based on the new Zen 3 Plus, while some of the U-series stuff is still older Zen 3, but at least they kept the naming for those parts to 5000 series. Last year, they had some Zen 2 parts with similar names to the Zen 3 parts and it was confusing, so this is better. Anyway, the H-series chips are what we'll see in the gaming laptops that I focus on. We've still got lower powered HS options for thinner and lighter designs. Otherwise, the naming scheme is much the same as last gen, just 6000 now rather than 5000. As core, thread, and cache counts are the same. The main differences are in the clock speeds, and of course the move to 6nm. AMD have provided some performance details, but of course, as usual, wait for third-party benchmarks and reviews before making a purchasing decision rather than relying on this information. In these brief examples, the new 6800U is looking quite a bit better compared to the 5800U. In terms of Cinebench performance, we're looking at a 1.3x boost to multi-core and a smaller 1.1x boost to single-core scores compared to last gen. Unfortunately, AMD have only provided comparisons using U-series rather than H-series, so I'm not sure at all how H-series stacks up right now. I'm going to be comparing AMD's new Ryzen 6000 processors against Intel's new 12th gen as soon as I can, so make sure that you're subscribed for that. Alright, now let's talk about what I think is the most interesting part, the integrated graphics within the processor. Let me explain why, but don't worry, we will be covering the more powerful Radeon discrete graphics after. Previously, Zen 2 and Zen 3 Mobile made use of Vega graphics, but now with this year's Zen 3 Plus, we're getting RDNA 2 graphics, just like the latest consoles and desktop graphics cards. Interestingly, this also means that the integrated graphics are now capable of ray tracing. I mean, I'm not expecting amazing RT performance or anything, but that's a first. Now, again, these benchmarks are provided by AMD, so take them with a grain of salt until we get these laptops to do our own testing. But basically, they're claiming that the 6800U's iGPU easily beats Intel 11th gen and Nvidia's MX450. Compared to last gen, in a number of games, there's apparently up to a 2x increase. So fairly big gains to the integrated graphics in just a single year. Of course, some of the gains would be due to CPU improvements rather than the iGPU standalone, but the point still stands in terms of a gen-on-gen comparison. Yeah, okay, great. Integrated graphics updates in a gaming laptop. Why should I care about that, I hear you say. Well, this is where it gets interesting. Well, AMD are also introducing SmartShift Eco, which does something I've never seen before. Basically, you can tell the laptop to move a graphical workload like a game from the discrete Radeon graphics over to the more power-efficient Ryzen processor's integrated graphics when you unplug from wall power. Once AC is plugged back in, it should shift back to the more powerful GPU. Don't worry, it's user-definable, so you can choose whether or not this happens. The goal of this option is to improve battery life while gaming or otherwise when using the GPU. And considering the iGPU improvements in games noted earlier, it may be capable of a decent experience. I've never seen this feature in any Intel or Nvidia gaming laptops before, so it'll be interesting to test out, as it's only available in AMD Advantage laptops, so both Ryzen processor and Radeon discrete graphics. Now, while I have absolutely no doubts that this would improve battery life as the integrated graphics just use less power than discrete graphics, it's really going to depend on how well the iGPU can actually run a game off of battery power. Because just in case you didn't know, generally when you unplug a laptop from wall power, the performance drops way down. Though of course it does depend on the specific machine. It's worth mentioning that the iGPU can make use of FSR, so in supported games, it's possible to gain an even further performance boost by enabling enabling this feature. Combined with the use of RDNA 2 graphics, we might actually have a decent shot of iGPU gaming outside of esports titles with all AMD laptops, which might mean gaming on battery becoming less terrible. AMD are making some big claims when it comes to battery life by saying up to 24 hours of runtime is possible with their new processors. I've checked the fine print, and this was done with a Ryzen 7 6800U laptop playing back a 1080p video file with a screen just 150 nits bright, but still not bad at all. Battery life and performance on battery is an area where my own testing found AMD's Ryzen 5000 processors last year to do better than Intel's 11th gen, so it'll be interesting to see how Ryzen 6000 compares against Intel's new 12th gen this year. According to AMD, the Ryzen 7 6800U is much more power efficient compared to the 5800U last year, using up to 40% less power in tasks like video streaming, which is a pretty big single generation improvement. Alright, now let's talk about AMD's new Radeon graphics for gaming laptops. So, the discrete Radeon graphics, that is, not to be confused with the Radeon integrated graphics as part of the processor. Kinda wish they had separate names, but here we are. So, just to be clear, now we're talking about the discrete graphics that compete with Nvidia. Last year, we were introduced to the Radeon RX 6800M, 6700M, and 6600M laptop GPUs. From my own testing, the 6800M was close to Nvidia's RTX 3080, the 6700M was between the 3070 and 3060, while the 6600M was close to the 3060 but a little behind. The performance on offer was far better compared to anything AMD had before in terms of laptop graphics. This year, AMD are announcing S versions of these same GPUs, the 6600S, 6700S, and 6800S. So another new letter to keep track of. But hey, at least unlike Nvidia's desktop and laptop GPUs, we can still tell the difference just from the name. I'm guessing the S stands for slim or something, as these GPUs are targeted towards thinner gaming laptops at under 20mm thick and under 4.5 pounds. Basically, the goal is more power efficiency in smaller laptop designs. Now, the specs for these S series GPUs haven't yet been provided, so I'm not sure if they're the same as the M series GPUs, but just with lower power limits. Kind of like what Nvidia did with their Max-Q GPUs a couple of years ago. We'll just have to wait and see.
Don't worry though, the M series GPUs are still getting an update. Like the processors covered earlier, these new GPUs will be based on 6nm. Apparently, this results in 14% additional performance with 7% higher clocks than the M series Radeon GPUs from last year. This is what else we're getting this year. At the top end, we're getting the new RX 6850M XT, which AMD is saying is 7% faster when compared to the RX 6800M, which was their best offering last year. We're also getting the new RX 6650M and RX 6650M XT, which are apparently 20% faster compared to the 6600M from last year. Now, this doesn't actually specify which one is 20% faster, so I'm going to assume they're referencing the better 6650M XT. In addition to that, we're also getting some new lower-end options, the RX 6500M and RX 6300M GPUs. Now, they're saying these are 200% faster compared to Nvidia's MX 450, but I don't think that's super useful given how niche the MX series is. I'd be more interested in knowing how they compare to, say, RTX 3050 and 3050 Ti. Now, there's more to this launch than just hardware. In Q1 this year, so sometime before April, AMD plans to launch Radeon Super Resolution, or RSR. According to AMD, RSR will allow us to get FSR performance boosts in nearly every game. While FSR needed individual game support, RSR is enabled in two simple steps. You just turn it on through the Adrenaline software and then lower the resolution through the game settings. RSR takes care of the rest, and you should get higher frame rates in most games.
There have, of course, been ways of making FSR work in games that don't natively support it out of the box. But now having this official support from AMD that just works in thousands of games is a great next step. Now, FSR works on both Nvidia and Radeon graphics, but as per the name, I'm guessing RSR probably only works on Radeon graphics, as it needs Radeon drivers to do so. I guess kind of how DLSS only works on Nvidia. Even if that's the case, FSR still works with Nvidia, so it's not as closed off as DLSS. I mean, even Nvidia closes DLSS off to Nvidia, because there are current-gen RTX graphics that can't use it. But wait, there's more.
AMD Advantage laptops are getting an upgrade too, with SmartShift Max. Just as a quick refresher, Smart Shift is basically AMD's equivalent of NVIDIA's Dynamic Boost, where power is shared between the CPU and GPU depending on the current running workload, with the goal of providing optimal performance for the situation. Now, the new Smart Shift Max works on the same principle, but it now works with more games. To be honest, I wasn't aware that it was only restricted to certain games previously, so it would be great to see a game list and know what's supported if that's the case. AMD provided the following example in four different games, comparing the performance gains between Smart Shift and Smart Shift Max. In Shadow of the Tomb Raider and The Division 2, it seems like the original Smart Shift didn't even help out, while Smart Shift Max offers improvements. Then in games like Strange Brigade and Godfall, the newer Smart Shift Max is able to offer higher gains compared to what was available previously. Smart Shift Eco is another new software feature for AMD Advantage laptops. But I covered that earlier, so let's move on. Next up, AMD is introducing Smart Access Graphics. Long story short, this seems to be their equivalent of NVIDIA's Advanced Optimus, as the principle sounds the same. Normally, the more powerful discrete graphics connects to the screen via the processor's integrated graphics, which increases latency and lowers frame rates. AMD Smart Access Graphics intelligently switches the display between Ryzen and Radeon GPUs to optimize battery life and enable maximum graphical performance. They're listing an average 15% performance boost here compared to traditional hybrid designs, which honestly sounds about right based on my own experience of testing laptops with and without a mux switch. Obviously, I support this change with open arms, as I'm a fan of the mux switch and believe it should be your choice whether or not you want to run your laptop on the integrated graphics for better battery life or on the discrete graphics for more performance in games. But even if you do have a laptop with a mux switch, honestly, it can be a little annoying rebooting every time you do want to swap. So I think this is a great next step in the evolution of this technology, as now both AMD and NVIDIA have similar options. AMD have listed a couple of laptops using their new hardware. Alienware are introducing an M17 R5 with Ryzen 6000 processor and up to the top-end RX 6850M XT graphics. And they're also saying this will be the most powerful all-AMD gaming laptop of the year. I'll have more info about it in tomorrow's Alienware video. ASUS have also refreshed their Zephyrus G14 in an all-AMD design. So both AMD Ryzen 6000 HS series processor with up to RX 6800S graphics. I suppose the use of the new S series makes sense, given the Zephyrus lineup is designed to be a thinner and lighter design. I've already got this one here, again, video soon. AMD are expecting 20 plus Advantage laptop designs throughout 2022, so there should be plenty more coming. This is quite a lot more compared to last year. I can only count about 5 or 6 from 2021. Here are a few more upcoming Ryzen laptops. I'm guessing these aren't all Advantage designs though, as I know this year's Blade 14 only uses NVIDIA graphics. What I found interesting was the Acer Nitro 5 appears to have a new design, or at least the lid is different than before. Anyway, availability for Ryzen 6000 laptops is expected in early February this year, though it wasn't made clear if the Radeon GPUs would launch at the same time, as Alienware have said their M17 R5 isn't coming till spring. You can check out more gaming laptops coming out this year in the rest of my CES 2022 coverage. And of course, make sure you're subscribed for when I get these new laptops in for benchmarking and review. I'm really keen to see how these new Ryzen 6000 CPUs compare against Intel's higher core and thread counts, and to see how the new Radeon graphics hold up against NVIDIA.